I would like to mention here that some or full content of this session may help you to be a cyber aware, being a cyber savvy, and help you to understand the security concepts while preparing for any cybersecurity exams like CISM, CISA, CISSP, etc. CISM, you can find this in domain 4, which is Information Security Incident Management, and CISSP, you can find under Security Operations.
Regarding disaster recovery, business continuity programs are designed to keep a business up and running in the fact of a disaster. But unfortunately, they don't always work. Sometimes continuity controls fail or the sheer magnitude of disaster overwhelms the organization's capacity to continue operations. That's where disaster recovery begins. Disaster recovery is a subset of business continuity activity designed to restore a business to normal operation as quickly as possible following a disruption. The disaster recovery plan may include immediate measures that get operations up and running again temporarily, but the disaster recovery effort is not finished until the organization is completely back to normal operation. The initial response following an emergency disruption is designed to contain the damage to the organization and recover whatever capacity may be immediately restored. The activities during the initial response will vary widely depending upon the nature of the disaster and may include activity and alternate processing facility containing physical damage or calling in contractor to begin an emergency response. During a disaster recovery effort, the focus of most of the organization shifts from normal business activity to a concentrated effort to restore operation as quickly as possible. From the staffing perspective, this means that many employees will be working in temporary jobs that may be completely different from their normal assigned duties. Flexibility is key during a disaster responses. Also, the organization should plan out disaster responsibility as much as possible in advance and provide employee with training that prepare them to do their part during disaster recovery. Communication is critical to disaster recovery effort. Responder must have secure reliability means to communicate with each other and with the organization's leadership. The communication includes the initial communication required to activate the disaster recovery process. Even if the disaster occur after business hour, it also includes regular status update for both employee in the field and leadership. It should include ad hoc communication capability to meet tactical needs. After the immediate danger to the organization clears, the disaster recovery team shift from immediate response mode into assessment mode. The goal of this phase is simple: to trace the damage to the organization and develop a plan to the recover of organization on a permanent basis. In some circumstances, this may also include intermediate steps that restore operation temporarily on the way to permanent recovery. There are two metrics used to help an organization plan disaster recovery effort. The recovery time objective, or we called as a RTO, is the targeted amount of time that it will take to restore a service to operation following a disruption. The organization must also think about the amount of data that it need to restore as well, and thus the recovery point objective, or RPO, is. This is the maximum time period from which data may be lost as a result of a disaster. Together, the RTO and RPO provide valuable information to a disaster recovery planner. After developing a plan, responder then execute the plan, restoring operations in an orderly fashion. Friends, remember, the disaster recovery effort only conclude when the organization is back to normal operation in the primary facility. Training and awareness efforts are critical component of a disaster recovery plan. That's a very important concept for all the students who are preparing for security certification. This is one of the very important point. Let me read it again. Training and awareness efforts are, I would say, one of the very critical way, and that we need to do on a regular basis, right? So training and awareness efforts are critical component of a disaster recovery plan. All personnel involved in disaster recovery effort should receive training about their role in the plan on a periodic basis, and also engage in more frequent awareness program designed to keep their disaster recovery responsibility top of mind. Hey, by the way, friends, do you know October month is for what with respect to the cybersecurity? Just Google it, or somebody can post in the chat, then that will be fine. Next one will be disaster recovery sites. This is also one of my favorite topic. Disaster recovery site, right? So during a disaster, organization may need to shift their computing functions from their primary data center to an alternate facility designed to carry the load when the primary site is unavailable or non-functioning. Disaster recovery sites are alternate processing facility specifically designed for this purpose. Most of the time, they sit idle, waiting to step in when an emergency situation arises. There are three main type of alternate processing facility: hot site, cold site, and warm sites. Hot sites. Hot sites are the premier form of disaster recovery facility. They are fully operational data center that have all the equipment and data required to handle operation ready to run. The technology staff can activate the hot site at a moment notice. And in many cases, the hot site will actually activate itself if primary sites fail. This provides an unparalleled level of redundancy, but it also comes at great price. It's a very expensive. The cost of building and maintaining the hot site are typically similar to those of running the primary data center. You are doubling your cost to achieve tremendous recovery capability. Cold sites. Cold sites, on the other hand, are facilities that may be used to restore operations eventually, but with a significant investment of time. They are essentially empty data centers. They have the core racks, cabling network connections, and environmental controls necessary to support data center operations, but they don't have the servers or data required to restore business operations. Cold sites are far less expensive than hot sites, but activating them may require weeks or even months of effort. Warm sites. Warm sites are compromised. They don't have hardware and software necessary to support the company's operations, but they are not kept running in the parallel fashion. The hardware costs are the same as the hot site, but warm site require much less investment of time from IT staff. Activating a warm site may take hours or days, depend upon the circumstances. Disaster recovery sites not only provide a facility or technology operations, but they also serve as an off-site storage location for business data. Backing up business data is important, and storing those backups in a secure facility that is geographically distanced from the primary facility provide added assurance that the same disaster will not damage both the primary facility and the backups. Backups may be physically transported to disaster recovery sites on a periodic basis, or they may be transferred digitally using a process known as electronic vaulting. Now, this is a very important point where you require to test BCP, BC and disaster recovery plan. Disaster recovery plan are critical to ensuring the continuity of business operations. As with any security controls, disaster recovery plan should be tested to ensure that the plan functions properly and will be ready to restore the business operation in the event of a disruption. Each test of disaster recovery plan has two goals. First, it validates that the plan functions correctly and that disaster recovery technology will work in the event of an actual disaster. Second, the disaster recovery test provides an opportunity to identify necessary update to the plan due to technology or business process changes. Let's talk about five types of disaster recovery testing: read through, walk through, simulation, parallel test, and full interruption test. Let's go one by one. Read through. Read through are the simplest form of disaster recovery testing. They are also known as checklist review. In this approach, disaster recovery staff distributed copies of the current plan to all personnel involved in disaster recovery efforts and asked those personnel to review their procedure. Team member then provide feedback about any update need to keep the plan current. Walkthrough go a step further and involve getting everyone together around the same table to review the plan. For this reason, a walkthrough is also known as a tabletop exercise. Walkthrough achieve the same result as read through, but are generally more effective because they give the team the opportunity to discuss the plan together. The next level of disaster recovery testing is simulation test. As with a structured walkthrough, simulation pulls the disaster recovery team together in the same room. The difference is that in simulation, they are not just talking about the plan itself. They are discussing how they will respond to a specific scenario. The test planner designs a simulation of an emergency situation, and then the disaster recovery team describes how they would react. The three test types we have discussed so far, read through, walk through, and simulation, are all theoretical exercises. They talk about disaster recovery but don't actually use any disaster recovery technologies. The parallel test goes beyond this and actually activates the disaster recovery plan, bringing up a hot or warm site in response to simulated disaster. The company doesn't actually switch operation to the alternate site, but the alternate site run in parallel to the primary site. The final test, the full interruption test, is the most effective type of disaster recovery testing, but it is also the most disruptive to normal operations. The business simulate a disaster by actually shutting down the primary site and attempting to operate out of the alternate facility. This type of test will highlight any deficiency in the plan, but may also have an adverse effect on the business. For this reason, full interruption tests are rare in practice. Oh, sorry, I forgot to move the slide. So this slide is for full interruption test, what I just mentioned. Disaster recovery testing. Disaster recovery testing strategies often use a combination of different test types. Organization might conduct regular read-through and walk-through of the plan and then supplement those walk-through and read-through with periodic simulation and parallel test. Each test type brings different advantages and help the organization become better prepared for an actual disaster. So friends, let me take the break here. I think that's all from my side.